myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. Stole many a man's soul and faith. I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. Me damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his fate. Pleased to meet you. Hope you guess my name. But what's puzzling you is the nature of my game. Get down.
Yo, what's going on? July 31st, trading deadline for MLB. You guys on the trading block?
I'm on waivers.
I'm still sick. I was at McGuire's on, it's July 31st. I was at McGuire's on Saturday night, you know, and it was like the first show starts at 7, and that's like real early in the summer because it's still light on everything.
Right.
So they're all old. I'm making fun of them. And there's one guy's like sitting right up front. He has like, it looks like a canteen something. It looks like an old thing canteen. So I pick it up to make fun of it because it looks like a purse. And they're all like, oh, whoa. It turns out it was his oxygen tank. And I could have killed him. I don't know what would have happened. It wasn't even his. It was his wife's who was sitting behind him. Because I made fun of him the rest of the show. I'm like, don't laugh too much because you might fucking croak. So then on the way out, I was selling T-shirts, and his wife was like, wrong person. So I was her thing. That's why I had like a design on it. It had like a design. It looked like a purse, like a you know, when guys used to have like a canteen?
Yeah, like in the days of the Wild West.
Yeah, they would have a fucking canteen. So I thought it was like, he was like an old prospector who had a canteen, and he put a design on it.
Wait, is he married? Honey, not, you know how women are always like, hold my purse, hold my oxygen for me.
We've been married 60 years.
I know you're married a long time.
We've been married 60 years. It was a beautiful thing. So it wasn't beautiful. It was kind of horrific. Anyway, so there we are. So anyway, Steve's here. Steve Marshall. Steve, lean into the mic if you're not too troubled. What time did you get up? Like an hour ago? Like these guys have like no responsibility. Like, you know, I'm a little under the weather. I'm not myself today. How many kids you got?
Zero.
How many wives you got?
One ex-wife.
What time did you wake up today?
Today I woke up at about 12:18.
Okay, good. Okay, we got Sean. Hey, Sean L. McCarthy. Is it McCarthy, right?
Yeah.
All right, I just looked at your thing because I was gonna. I don't want to get it wrong. Anyway, Sean, tell them who you are because they know Steve. Steve's been here before.
Yeah, well, I used to be a newspaper reporter when that was a thing, but now that there's
for who?
Most recently, the Daily News here in New York.
Oh yeah, you work for the Daily News, right? That's when we all met. You work for the Daily News, right?
Yeah, I moved here 10 years ago and was working for the Daily News.
What'd you do there?
I was a pop culture entertainment reporter.
All right, that's how you met us, all right.
Most of you, some of you I met on the road when I was either at the Boston Herald or the Arizona Republic in Phoenix.
And you were there before the Daily News?
Correct.
And so you got here and then you thought you were set for life and then newspapers went out of business, right?
Correct.
All right. So now you're like an independent contractor, correct?
Yes. I freelance and I also run my own website, The Comics Comic.
Comics Comic. And everybody likes that. Anyway, I was reading
Not
some
everybody.
Of your... I was reading some of your posts yesterday on Facebook because, you know... Yesterday was my day off, even though my fucking kids were, my wife was working, so I had to watch my kids, so it's not really a day off, but I didn't have to do anything.
Right.
Anyway, at one point I fell asleep on my couch, and my son yells cannonball and jumps on my stomach.
Oh, that's not right.
No, it's fucking painful.
Did he make waves?
Yeah, and then at one point he fell, then he was doing other shit, then he fell off the couch. Mm-hmm. And he fell on like one of his toys. So he's like, "You broke my back." And so then he started crying. I go, "Get the fuck." I was so pissed at this point. I'm like, I said, "You're in timeout," even though he was in pain. I go to your fucking room. So then he took a nap.
How old is he?
5. Then last night, then we walked to the store last night. Cause you know, when they take a nap, they're not going to go to sleep. So I want to give him some exercise. We're walking to the store and he goes, "Oh, look at that freaking car." I go, "Where'd you learn?" Where'd you learn freaking from? He goes, "I don't know."
From you?
Freaking? No, I don't say freaking. I say fucking. I say fucking Bobby Kelly. Anyway, The other day he goes, Dad, do we have an Uncle Lenny? I go, no, we don't have a fucking Uncle Lenny. Steve, talking to the mic. Jesus.
I'm not saying anything. I'm listening. I have to listen into the mic.
You're too tired to say something. Pretend you're on TV.
Oh, yeah.
Steve's like this.
I'm relaxed.
What?
Took me years to get relaxed.
It's like being on delay. Anyway, so Sean was in Montreal, right?
Yeah, I was there for my 11th consecutive Just for Laughs festival.
And how was it?
It was good on the whole. It was,
everyone killed, right?
Most everyone
if
killed.
Everybody kills, what's the point? What's the point?
Everyone killed, everyone got a development deal.
You're almost better. I mean, that's the joke, but you're almost better bombing because then people will talk about you. How are you going to, like, if everyone kills, if the crowds are so good, what's the fucking point?
I think
that's like a hypothetical. Or
well, at this point, the comedians call it summer camp.
Yeah,
so I guess it doesn't matter. Everybody gets a participation trophy.
You don't make money.
You get a ribbon.
And then you go up there. You can pretend like you see everybody. You're like, hey, how you doing? And it's just whatever.
Yeah, it's changed from 20 years ago.
Yeah, because back in the day, you would suck your left dick because you would get a development deal worth like millions of dollars. Not millions, but you would get like a quarter million.
Enough to keep you set for the next couple of years.
Well, maybe a year. Quarter million. You get a $250,000 development deal.
Yeah.
If you had a good New Faces. Even that was ridiculous because New Faces, to give a guy a development deal, New Faces, because he doesn't know what he's doing. Geraldo got like a big development deal out of Montreal. They did a sitcom and it stunk. You know what I mean? So Then 10 years later, he's good. So guys, when they have 7 minutes, are not good comics anyway.
Well, there was that infamous story of that guy called Chicken.
Oh, Chicken, yeah. And then he killed himself, right?
Killed himself about 5 years ago, yeah.
What?
Not because of Montreal.
Not because of Montreal. But
no, but that's still...
He actually watched his act, and then he killed himself.
But he was infamous, yeah, because his act was essentially, like, no act, hardly.
Yeah, but he killed, right?
He
every
killed,
show?
And he got a huge development deal. And
the WB or somebody?
And then he had a co-starring role in the movie Triple X, the Vin Diesel movie that's not The Fast and the Furious.
And then that was
and
it?
Nothing,
and why'd he kill himself?
Well, I don't know. I don't have an alibi.
Anyway,
he's not an investigative reporter.
I brought you here.
Yeah, let's get into it.
Sean,
a feeling what's going on.
There was an article in the New York Times about the Comedy Cellar.
Yes.
Anyway. Yeah,
let's talk about that.
All right, so let's go to this. I don't want to name names, but here, I got to take my glasses off to read this. Anyway. Do you know this guy?
Jason Zinnemann, yeah. We do it.
Oh, no, do you know this guy? After the Trump jokes? Do you know his name?
Azar Usman?
Yeah, don't say his name.
That's why I don't lean into the mic.
That was a fake name.
Yeah, that was that you
it changed the name to prevent.
Anyway, so he says this is Saturday night. He goes, in a night, this is his reporting, which I'm calling fake news.
Oh, right. I saw that tweet of yours. Okay.
In a night rich with Trump jokes, this comic, I'm not gonna say his name because let's just say he's not white. He's not black.
Right.
He's not a woman. He's other, but he's very distinct looking.
Yes.
Okay. Does the most overtly political set with densely argued premises and fewer punchlines. I'll say zero punchlines because I was watching it.
It was more of a rant.
It wasn't a rant. It was like a honk, a chunk of material that got nothing. It wasn't jokes.
Not even a political applause break.
No. This style tends to work better in alternative rooms than in clubs. He describes the president as the head of the white civil rights movement and explains that there are four kinds of white people. The first, he says, are the white devils. The crowd gets quiet. He smiles. First of all, the crowd was quiet the whole time, okay?
Right.
So, because it turns out I was on next. I went down there. No, when I'm next, I go down.
So you're watching the whole thing.
No, I go down to watch. If I'm next, I go down to watch. And plus, he was the first guy in the late show. So I got nothing else to do. I don't want to talk to Ben Bailey upstairs. So I go downstairs.
Right.
And Steve's talking to the fucking mic. Steve, sit up. Jesus Christ. So anyway, so I'm down there. And I don't know what time I turn my tape recorder on, how deep into the set. Mm-hmm. But I'm taping my set. So when I see the MC, I usually cue my...
Just to make sure it's on.
Yeah, to make sure it's on. Yeah. So if he gets off quick and they bring me right up, I don't have to be fiddling with my phone.
Right.
Anyway, so he goes way long. I have it all on my phone.
Mm-hmm.
He does. I have 7 minutes of him on my phone, 3 mild chuckles in 7 minutes. And it's not even funny. It's just all political. It's about like how, you know, white people are bad and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, so he bombs. I'll call it a bomb.
Mm-hmm.
This guy's calling it... it tends to work better in alternatives. I don't know where this
would
work.
Is he auditioning?
Oh, no, he passed.
Really?
And the crowd gets quiet. He smiles. Mm-hmm. He ends with, I mean, I have it all on tape. I don't know if I have permission to play it. But anyway,
right now.
Then he goes, Kevin Brennan walks on stage, looks at a guy in the front
row.
Says, you the white devil? First of all, it's not that simple. The guy, I walked up to, like, death, okay? Mm-hmm. The MC brought me up, and, she did a joke. She did fine. She did a joke, and, you know, she wasn't going to manage the whole room because he was the first comic, and he did a long set and bombed.
Who was MCing?
Lisa.
Okay.
So then she brings me up. She does a good job bringing me up. Then I say to a guy, you know, I can't just go right into material because the crowd's like not in the mood for that.
Right, you have to.
Because I'm a professional comedian. I've been in that situation. I know what they need. So I talk to a guy in the front. He's a good looking guy. I go, blah, blah, blah. Nice haircut. So you're the white devil? Big laugh. He doesn't mention I get a laugh. Then he says, then he says, Brennan walks on stage, looks at a guy in the front row. You the white devil? Big laugh. Okay.
Yeah.
It's on tape. I got it on fucking tape. Then the next line is, when a joke earns a groan, he quips, I'm going to bring back the other guy. First of all, I didn't do a joke that got a groan. I was talking to the crowd after I said the white devil thing. I said to a guy, anyone from the South just setting up a joke, an easy joke of mine. Anyone from the South? People are kind of getting a little bit rowdy. So I go, calm down or else I'll bring the other guy back. It wasn't a joke. I didn't get a groan. So this guy with his fucking fake news, I mean, it's totally fake news. So my point is, did he record the set or does he go by memory and just basing it on his memory and then hopefully he's right? Because he never mentioned I got a laugh. When I listened to my set, this guy did set. I have 7 minutes of this guy at my tape. Right. Getting three little laughs. And basically, it's all like nervous laughter. It wasn't like a laugh off a real joke.
Right.
Just like the nervous, like when a guy's ranting and then he stops or whatever. He ends with, thanks for the laugh. Thanks for the laughs. I love you. And then he does with the fucking dumb thing with his, like, when you win an award, you tap your heart or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, first of all, there's no laughs and you don't love them. It's like, it's such fucking bullshit. But he doesn't, he makes me look like the dick. Like, he never mentioned I got a laugh. When a joke earns a groan, he quips, I'm going to bring the other guy back. That's it. So he never mentioned I got a laugh. He mentioned the guy before me gets a laugh with densely argue and fewer punch signs. The crowd gets caught, you know.
I've been to shows with this guy from the times before, and if it was anything like the shows I've attended with him, he doesn't record them. He has a notepad and writes down notes, so.
Yeah.
What's the name of the reporter? Can we say that? Because I know a lot of guys that I actually read
the
bylines,
right?
On people.
Yeah. Jason
Zinnemann. Yeah, he just wrote a new biography about Letterman.
Yeah, you read it?
I haven't yet, no. But it's gotten great reviews. It's a bestseller.
What's the point of the article?
It was he was spending a weekend at the late shows at the Cellar.
Okay.
Which I don't know if he arranged that with Esty and Gnome or told them about it after the fact.
He did.
That's interesting in itself.
So is the article all about this guy and his rant, or is the article just about an evening? I didn't read the article. Just an evening at the Cellar.
I think it's
too
evening.
Lenny's in the picture, which made me... People are like, oh, you must be furious. First of all, that's Lenny's fucking wet dream. You know what I mean? Lenny wants to do is be like a regular at the Cellar, which is fine, but it doesn't pay my bills. I can't just be doing three spots a night at the Cellar and it pays my bills. So I guess Lenny's independently wealthy. Here's the point. The guy is, it's now I know why Trump says fake news, because it's like, that's not what happened. Like, that's not what happened. He never mentioned I got a laugh. Clearly the guy was bombing. But maybe because he's not, he looks kind of like a terrorist. It's not appropriate to say the guy bombed, or you can't say it a bomb. But he never mentioned I got a fucking laugh. I got laughs throughout my whole set. I had to get laughs off the other guy's bombing. You know what that's like, right? Is Steve, a guy bombs, and you have to like...
I'm talking about you bombing. He's saying...
No, if another guy bombs...
You get what he's saying? What's going on? I'm talking in the mic now.
If another guy bombs, you can't just go up and act like it didn't happen.
No, you got to reset the room.
Right, and also...
You have to reset the room.
Tempo's all off.
The fact that this guy acts like he's a comedy First of all, he knows nothing about comedy. He's never done stand-up. He can observe comedy all you want, and it's not. It's like observing guys playing poker, and they go like, I know how to play poker. No, you know nothing about playing poker. Even if you watch it on TV, you know nothing about playing poker. You have to play poker at high stakes to understand it. So it's like, you can't just go, well, no, what I saw was, no, what you saw was a guy go long, bomb, and then I have to go up, and then you don't even mention I get a fucking laugh. So it's just bad reporting. It's bad. But he don't give a fuck, because what's going to happen? I'm going to do this? I'm not famous. I can't fucking trash him. I can't send my Twitter followers after him.
Unless,
you know,
this gets famous. This
no,
episode.
But then he'll go, well, you know, that's how I remembered it. Or I go, well, I have it on fucking tape. And that's one of the reasons why I tape, because if there's any kind of, like, something happens, I go, it's right here.
You got to tape all the time.
I got it right here. No, I got it right here. So even when I read it, I was like, I go, what? Like, he didn't even mention that I have to reset the room. I'm getting laughs off the guy.
He doesn't understand what he's...
Like, no, he makes it seem like I'm the dick.
I remember seeing your tweet about this when you called it fake news.
Yeah.
Did he get the other comedians pretty accurately, or was he off base with the other ones, too?
No, I didn't see them.
The
did
article...
Did you talk to any of the other people to see if...
No, because first of all, he's there looking for Amy. He actually says he's looking for, like... He's trying to find the title of the article is what? What's it called again?
Oh, is he hoping for one of those unannounced drop-ins?
Dropping in at the Comedy Cellar with Amy Schumer and Leslie Jones.
Is he hoping for like a Chappelle drop-in or something?
Well,
like that?
Yeah, of course. So he went there on a Friday. I know he was there on a Friday, and then I guess he came the next night too. So
maybe he just doesn't like the Brennans.
It doesn't even matter.
No,
maybe it's a blood feud.
What happens is people don't see things. It's just their perception, which is not necessarily a correct
perception.
That's
why I'm saying that's why the fake news, like even the fake, even with Trump, you know, when I was reading the New York Times before the election, they made it seem like all the Trump rallies were duds. Like every rally, there was nobody there, and people were, he would go there wherever at 2 a.m. Yeah, he would go there wherever, and then people in the Trump campaign. I'm not supporting Trump in this. I'm just saying, like, what you see is fake news, because that's not what happened. He made it seem like I'm the dick going up, and like this guy. He didn't say the guy bombed. He said like he had a densely. It was like it's fucking ridiculous. Like even while I'm watching, I'm going like, you have no jokes.
So he was kinder to that guy than he was to you.
Yeah, much. He made him, and again,
the sets were the other way around. He was kinder to the other guy than to you, even though the sets were the other way around.
Right. Yeah, he made it seem like I
That's
was
unfortunate.
Just... Yeah, he made it seem like... And again, like, it doesn't matter because no one's going to fucking read the New York Times comedy section, because that's not how the world works now. Like, nobody's going to go like, oh, my God, the New York Times, they did something on the comedy. The only person that cares is me and the Comedy Cellar. Yeah. Because I was portrayed badly in it.
But you just got to make sure that Noam and Esty don't frame it and put it on the wall.
No, it doesn't even matter, because it's like I know what happened, and I know, but the fact that like comedy now is like if you're a white dude, you're like fucking, you know what I mean? Like if you're like white and you're not famous, you're like you're like fucking, what do they give you in between like meals? Like
intermezzo?
The palate cleaner, cleanser.
Intermezzo? Sorbet.
Yeah. So you go up and they're like, oh, this guy, he's just here to clean up after this guy. Mm. You know, he knows how to do comedy. The other guy's a revolutionary. You know, because the guy probably thinks he's a revolutionary, and then they're looking for...
Because he's Muslim, or...
Because he's whatever, because he's different. No, he's like, he's got a message. It's like, nobody gives a fuck. They're here to laugh.
Right. Especially 1 a.m.
No, and he has no joke. So the crowd's looking at him, and they're not going to heckle him because they figure he might fucking detonate himself, you know?
Yeah.
But with me, they're like, you know, well, yeah, the white guy knows how to do comedy because he's got a good credit score, and I'll go up and do comedy. So I'm just like an afterthought to this guy.
Is that a typical touristy crowd that night?
No, it wasn't a typical anything. It was a typical, like, you know, it was just a weird show because he went first after the MC, and he went extremely long. He went way over his after they lit him, and then he's not getting any laughs. And then I got to go up, and
probably why he went long, because he wasn't getting any laughs.
No, but that's idiotic. No, if you're bombing, just end it.
Right.
I mean, I'm thinking like even when I was watching, I'm like, he don't have any jokes. He don't have any jokes that just make people laugh. Like, why is it even doing comedy? He don't have like a little 3-minute hunk that'll just make people laugh. Like even if he's just making fun of himself or whatever. So, and then I read this, I'm like, oh yeah, now I'm the dick. I'm the dick, even though I basically, you know, kept the show going after this guy fucking handed me the fucking shit baton.
How was the shit baton? That's funny. How was your set?
I just said I killed.
You killed, so that's...
No, but he doesn't...
You're upset the guy didn't write that you killed.
No, it's not even that. He didn't even mention that I got a laugh. He mentioned the fact that, like, I went up, I said, you're the white devil,
right.
which is, like, an easy thing to say because he's calling the fucking white people white devils.
Right, it's a callback.
And then I'm doing it as a callback. It immediately gets a laugh, breaks the fucking tension in the room, and then I say, I'll bring the other guy back because they don't even want him back. That's the fucking oldest callback. That's the oldest callback in the world, too, when the guy bombs you. Go, I'll bring the other guy back. I'll bring the black guy back. I'll bring the woman back.
I get it.
Steve, you act like you don't even know what I'm talking about.
I do know what you're talking about,
Jesus,
but I'm also...
Christ, you act like you don't even do stand-up. Steve looks at me like I'm talking to my dentist.
No, because first of all, I think you're pissed. Nobody wants to be written up.
It's fake news. It's fake news.
Now you're attaching the word.
It's not a fact. How do I challenge this guy? Because he's got, that's why people get mad at reporters, because they have the whatever you call that, the power of the pen.
Right.
And then how do I challenge that? Even if he does a retraction and I meet him, I go, listen to my show, and then he'll put a retraction. No one's going to fucking read the retraction.
But he's not really.
And he'll go, oh yeah, maybe you're right. Maybe I should have mentioned that it got a laugh when you said that. Right. As opposed to like, then he did a joke. So it made it seem like this guy did a lot of fucking political stuff. And then I had a set with groans in it. So it's bad reporting. But anybody else, any celebrity comic, he's like, he probably got all the details right. Because he's like, he don't want them to get mad at him.
Well, that is what I just read the whole piece, and it's just laced with the proper names, you know, Leslie Jones, Dave Attell, Amy Schumer. You don't know who'll drop in. In fact, I don't even think Dave came off great in it. You know what I mean? I think, you know, reporters, and I don't call this alt news, but they're looking for an angle or a certain agenda, and he's just trying to give you, like, snapshots.
That's my point, Sean. So is all reporters looking for an angle? I mean, reporting's not as simple as it used to be because it's not, every town doesn't have one paper, so there's a lot of competition. Right. So are you looking for an angle?
Of course, I can't speak for all reporters, but I can say that since things have moved to the internet and since Twitter and Facebook have made the ability to share things even more relevant, that a lot of reporters or freelancers, not necessarily looking for an agenda, but are looking for something that'll get the clicks.
I think that is what's going on with this.
So,
and I think that's a sound bite. First of all, I happen to know reporting pretty well, and I have a friend who writes for the Times, whatever. There's nothing wrong with this guy's writing, but that's not what I would call a great investigative piece of journalism he's doing. It's a puff piece, P-U-F-F.
It's a slice of life at the Cellar.
It's a puff piece. It's not like they're sending Woodward and Bernstein down to the Comedy Cellar. But I do think what you're trying to say, Kevin, is don't walk in with the story written before you go in. Go in and observe. And then you know what? Why not go up to Kevin Brennan after the show and say, find out what really went on. Ask you, why did you open with that joke? Go up to Dave and say, what goes on here? Try and get a feeling for what's going on instead of just...
I did a professional set because when I went up there, I was addressing him bombing, and then I did a couple of jokes, easy jokes, just to get the crowd going because the crowd's like, at this point, they need to laugh because they're at a comedy show. They're at the Cellar. They expect to have a good time. They waited in line. And then, you know, they see the first guy, he's weird. And then if I go up there with a lot of attitude and, like, just doing whatever the fuck I want.
What's the opening set? First of all, that's not the correct opening set either. That's not the way, you know, when an audience first, if you want to talk a little bit about comedy, the comedian, the MC should come out, hi, how are you? How you doing? Is this the first time? Welcome. We have a great show.
He wasn't the opening. He was the first after the MC.
Yeah, that's what I mean. And then, but the first act traditionally is a little more down the pipe.
Yeah, but
in the middle of the room.
But sometimes the SD will put a guy who's like unpredictable early, because then get
just
him
to
out,
get it out of the way.
Get out of the way.
But that makes your spot hard.
No, I know, but that's why she puts me next. No, she knows what she's doing. She puts me next because she knows I'll know what to do.
Right.
Like if it's the boat's sinking, I'll know what to fucking do.
Right.
I might not save the boat, but I'll know what to do.
Right. Let's just say, for lack of something better, let's just say a big argument breaks out in the audience between the comedian and somebody in the audience, and then they give them the light, they get off. You can't just go up there and go, wow, today I was shopping at the 7-Eleven for a Slurpee. You can't go right into your material.
Yeah.
No, part of the problem with stand-up now is like you have to constantly follow people. You have to play off of what they did. And at the Cellar, sets are short, so you don't have a lot of time. So if the guy before you bombs or kills, you have to do a set according to that. You can't just go up and do whatever the fuck you want. So when this guy's like doing this, I'm like, I mean, he seems like a nice guy, and I don't have a problem with like him as a person, but it's like if you go up and then for the reporter to just not acknowledge it was just, you know, to basically make excuses. He's making excuses for him.
He's not knowledgeable. It's like
let me finish. He's making excuses for him. Like, he, you know, this plays better in all rooms, and, right, you know, it's more arguments that are more about arguments than jokes. So he's making excuses for him. For right. me, he's like, this guy, and then this guy goes up and he goes, I'll bring the other guy back, and yeah. are you the white devil? Both to big laughs.
Yeah.
So he doesn't say that. He just goes like, and then this fucking hack
So why
walks
is he
up.
Saying this? First of all, in real reporting, you're objective. You shouldn't be being subjective.
That's what I'm asking
saying,
Sean. Does he just go from memory? Because if he goes from memory, he'll go, well, that's how I remember. But like, right. okay, well, then don't fucking report it. Don't act like you got it word for word. Because he's quoting me. He's quoting lines. And then he's acting like, well, this is how it went. That's not how it went. I fucking recorded it.
Right. Well,
recorded it.
If you're not recording it, the trick is, you know, when you're remembering a quote, then you're writing that down. And while you're writing that down, you're still going.
Right.
So
he's missing. That's why you record yourself, because if I do a joke and I'm trying to remember how it goes, right. I'm trying to remember it in my memory, I'm not even paying attention to what I'm doing. So if this guy's writing down, he yeah. might still think he's hearing it, but he's not. He's multitasking. So the whole show was this. The first guy was weird, and then the rest of the show was like got normal. I made the show normal, and I'm not even patting myself on the back. I'm just saying I made the show normal, and then the rest of the show was normal.
If I were writing this story for the Times, you know, it's been a while since I've spent like a weekend down watching the shows. So I would, you know, I would be writing the slice of life about what happened the night I was there, but I would want to put it in context, which is why I was asking you just now, like, what was that crowd like? Was it a typical crowd?
Absolutely typical crowd. Out of towners, probably.
Because I'd want to put this weekend in perspective.
Right.
Like,
you have
is
to
this
say,
a typical weekend?
Right,
or
you
is
have
this,
to be able to say, listen,
this is unusual.
The first guy, whatever his name was, he wasn't a punchline driven comedian, but this crowd wasn't exactly a laugh driven crowd. You know, give like a feeling for
the crowd.
I don't
know what the fuck you're saying, Steve. Here's the point.
Oh my God. That's why I don't lean in.
Here's the point. Like when they did the 10 people to watch, Rolling Stone did the 10 comics to watch.
All those lists are horrible.
But there was no white guys. There was not a single white guy except for Tim Dillon, who's gay.
Well, those lists are horrible because they're not heavily researched. It's usually...
No, but it's also like nobody gives a fuck. If you're a white guy and you're not famous, they assume you're a loser. Like you're an absolute loser. So they're looking for somebody famous. And if they don't know you, mm-hmm. or they're looking for like somebody different, so when I go, I'm offended. So when I go up there, the guy's like, "Well, you're just a piece of shit, right?" I'm like, "Right, right. I have no point of view, because I don't go up there and do my fucking 15 minutes about my fucking point of view, because the crowd don't want that. They want jokes. So this guy does his point of view on life. Nobody gives a fuck. Do your fucking jokes, you know?
Yeah.
So they're like, well, this guy, we know what you do, right? Your wife and your kids and your fucking credit score, and you pay your taxes, and you're not, you know, there's nothing that when visually you're not interesting compared to this guy, because this guy looks fucking weird. So,
well,
so, so I just get to the point where I'm like, holy fucking shit. Like that. Now I know why everyone's right.
Well, in other words, he's already leaning in with this might work better in an alternative room, and then you're juxtaposed as the next guy he's reviewing. So do you feel he's saying about you that you're not...
I'm a hack. Here's a hack. He does a hacky thing.
Right.
He does the hack callback.
He doesn't do the hip alternative rooms. He's got funniness.
No, he does the
goes for a punchline.
He does the hack callback, and then he does the hack. Bring the guy back up after he does a laugh. Then he does a joke of his own that gets a groan. Anyway, I didn't get to do a joke. So the guy's like, but the guy doesn't give a shit, because what am I going to do? How do I fight back? This? I mean, I can do this, and I can tell people to fucking, but you know, the point is that he's the New York Times, and you know, he's probably friends with Noam, because they want to write up in the New York Times, even though they do 7 shows a night on the fucking weekend. They don't even need
it's all sold out.
Yeah, they don't even need the business,
right.
But they still would rather get a thing on the New York Times.
It's prestigious.
Yeah, so, but again, the New York Times is for arts and fucking leisure. I mean, this guy did a write up on Todd Barry, making Todd Barry seem like he was fucking good, so the guy's a hack. A fucking hack.
Well,
nobody calls him on it, because again, they're afraid of the guy, because he's the
right.
Comedy thing. So they want to keep on his good side. I'm like, fuck this guy. Fuck this guy. What's he gonna do? Bash me? It'd be great for my career if you fucking bash me.
So he has knowledge of comedy, this guy. This is
he thinks he knows comedy because he hangs around comics and comic clubs. But unless you do comedy, you don't know fucking comedy.
It's true.
So this guy doesn't know what I'm dealing with. I'm going up the fucking crowd. They haven't laughed in 20 minutes, barely. Mm. And then they're like, what the fuck is this? And then I go up. I do callbacks. I mean, anybody would do what I did. Anybody. They just, if the last guy bombs, you fucking address it. Because you can't just go on, because the crowd's already flat.
Well, that's why, like I said, if I were doing the story, I would put it into context, because the context means everything. Because you're set in context.
And again, I have it all on tape. I'm not making
context,
this up.
In context, you realize why your set was the way it was, because in context, you had to follow this other guy. You know, I
mentioned I got a laugh. He mentioned I got a groan. He never mentioned I got a laugh. Even though I didn't get a fucking groan.
I was facing a similar thing up in Montreal last week because.
No, I know. That's why I wanted to bring you in.
Because
you're reporting things. You have your opinion. People don't want your opinion, right? They just want you to whitewash. They want you to say it's great, even if it's not great.
Well, but also specifically with the new faces, like the new faces, they feel like this is their one shot now, and if they don't do well, they're screwed. And the fact is, there's hardly anybody writing about new faces, even though the industry desperately wants to know what's going on with new faces. So it ends up leaving it all to me to sum up, how did the new faces show go?
How many new faces were there?
Well, now there's several dozen, because they've expanded it to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They have 5 different groups now.
You know, can we just cut to
they
it?
Have 5 different groups
new,
of new
how
faces.
Did Sean? You're such a nice guy. I can tell you're a nice guy. I don't know if that leads to good reporting or not. But how did the new faces go?
They're all right. There were some that.
How new are they?
Well, that's the thing. Is that most of the new faces have representation, so they're not necessarily new.
Do they get representation after they get booked for it?
No. Montreal had to create a separate group about 5 years ago that's called Unrepped, just to make sure that there was one group of new faces that was coming in without managers or agents.
Yeah, you know,
because
what?
The rest of them already come in with representation, because we're in a comedy boom, and so everybody's getting snapped up, even if they're not.
Are they saying, so there's a group of new faces that are unwrapped? They're called Unwrapped?
They're called Unwrapped.
They probably get the most attention, right?
You would think so, but they haven't been the last couple years.
There's a new group of new faces called Bringers. They have that also at Montreal now.
I can't laugh because I'll start coughing.
Actually, the newest one this year.
You're warming me up now. Now I'm awake.
The newest one this year was called Creators, which is essentially YouTube stars. But if,
really?
But a couple
they
of them.
Do a set? They do a set?
No, they showed their clip reel, and then they invited them on stage for a short interview.
Really?
But
who hosts that? A comic?
No, a YouTube person.
Oh, my God.
But what's crazy about that is that there's a few people from that group of, like, 6. There's a few of them who already have 3 million YouTube subscribers, so they're already set. They don't.
They just go to go.
They just go for a free trip.
Could you imagine now if they actually start booking people, let's say, just for laughs, just because they have so many friends and family that will show up? You'll make sure that there are people in the audience? Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, but I don't understand. I don't know how many, they have so many shows up there. How do they get all the people? Like, where do the people come from? Everywhere? All over Canada?
Audience?
They just flood Montreal. Everyone goes to 20 shows. I just can't imagine. There's so many shows. They're like, but what's there's so many shows, and do they even have the audience for it? It just seems like they wouldn't even have the audience for it.
Well, how many people are at a New Faces show? How many people?
No, they have show after show after show.
Well, give me an example. Are there 50 people in the audience? Or are there 150 people in the audience?
The first night they had them in a theater where there were maybe a few hundred.
What's a few hundred? 250?
Maybe 400 or 500.
Oh, that's great. And then what happens the next night?
The second time they had them in a separate venue in a black box where there's like 50 people.
Okay.
So when the guys do new faces, are they good? Are you think they're funny or they're just so-so?
Most of them already have, you know, they have a solid 5-10 minutes, but you don't
know. Does it make you laugh?
You don't know if they have more than that.
Yeah, but does it make you laugh?
Let me ask you this. Was it repetitive what you saw? Was everybody doing Tinder jokes or were they really unique and had a different point of view?
I'm kidding. I can't even do it anymore. My Tinder joke's fucking dated anyway.
There's some similarities. Like there's a group called Characters, which is essentially their version of a Saturday Night Live audition.
Really?
So they get the people who do impressions and.
Did you want? Were you?
There were two back to back who had a character that was a Westworld robot. Right.
Can you name two or three people that you saw that? Let's do something positive.
Okay.
Name two or three people that you saw that were great.
Sam Jay, who's a comic out of Boston, who did Kimmel earlier this year.
I'm so sick of hearing the credits. What did they do? Like, if you go to see Muhammad Ali, you want to say, well, he fights, he puts his hands down, he has great footwork, or Tyson, he's got a knockout. I'm sick of the credits. What did he do?
The credits do matter.
Yeah.
Well, I'm oh, my God, he said he was on Saturday Night Live. I mean, it does matter that
I'm also letting people know where they can look
up. He's a new face, and he was on Saturday Night Live? What chance do we have?
I'm saying if you do Kimmel First of all, Kimmel don't even have comics anymore.
Barely, like three.
Right. So it must have been like an inside job, right? They have the same manager or something?
I have
no
idea.
Look at what comedy is.
I have no idea how they're booking it.
Who are they?
That's usually, it's got to be an inside
funny.
Job.
Nobody said about Don Rickles, he did this, he did, they said he insulted people, it was funny, he did, you know, what was funny about
you're
Sam
talking about
Jay.
Don Rickles, who's like the bad, who's like the one of the greatest of all time. It's like saying, nobody kills like Hitler, you know what I mean? It's like, it's like you can't compare, just because the guy's a dick, you can't say he's not as big a dick as Hitler.
But don't put a guy... Don't put a guy up because he only killed 1,000 Jews. I mean, at least try and kill 2 or 3 million if you're on the same show with Hitler.
So here's what I'm asking Sean. Yeah. Like, was there anybody where you go like, oh, that guy seems like he's really funny? Not like does he have a good set?
Right.
Like,
it looks like he'll have a development deal or he's.
They don't
good
do development deals anymore. I mean,
there
they do little development deals.
There are a few of them. Like Sam Jay, she came out.
Oh, it's a lady.
Yeah.
Oh, forget it then.
She's a black lesbian lady.
Oh no!
Home run!
Yeah.
Home run!
Where's Zeno Man when you need her? Hey Zeno Man, I got a black lesbian for you. Anti-white man.
He was talking about how she's married, but she's looking forward to getting divorced, and
she's married.
Look at everything going for her.
She's a black lesbian. She's married to a man.
No, they have gay marriage.
They have a gay marriage. And she's on your team. She wants to get divorced. She's got everything going for her.
You feel sorry for her on every level.
Right. Did she eat kale? Did she talk about eating kale too? She's got every topic.
She talked about scissoring.
Yeah.
And how she doesn't get.
Because I can't talk about that. I can't talk about scissoring.
She's actually not a fan of scissoring.
Aw. I'd be like, aw. What'd she say? It's too much work.
Scissoring's too much work.
Well, what do you know about scissoring?
I know plenty. I know what scissoring is for our listeners. It's probably two lesbians who go like this, okay? And
yeah, so how often have you done that?
What do you mean how? I've done it, but my penis is inside the woman when I scissor.
No, you've
my
never
cock
scissored.
Is in there. I've had it with you and your nice guy image. Now you got me. I'll burn a bridge with this cocksucker. Comics, comic.
Oh yeah, we're burning bridges. That's right. There was a guy, Rami Youssef.
Yeah.
He was.
He's a terrorist name. Sammy J. Rami Youssef. Was there a Bob Smith on the show?
Wait, Rami's definitely something, right? Arab or something, or?
Oh yeah, he's Muslim.
That's what I'm saying. Like when I go up there, you know, like my podcast is all about like burning bridges and making those comedy because. It's like, what's the fucking, you know what I mean? Like, to just be a typical white guy is nobody gives a fuck. Nobody gives a fuck. But if you're like a Rami or they're like, what? And then what happened?
There was a white guy, a ginger. Does that still count?
I hate that term ginger, too. Nobody said the word ginger 10 years
redhead.
Ago. It's just another buzzword. Like when
redhead?
People say, hey, buddy, hey, buddy, hey, buddy. I know what it is, Sean. I know what scissoring is.
Steve, I liked it better when you were not talking. Anyway, here's my thing about scissor, about
yeah, what's your point on scissor?
About gingers. Yeah. Ginger is the new, like, if you're going to be white, you got to be, I've already said this on my other show. I said, you, if you're going to be white.
Pale and redheaded?
You got to be super white, because that's like, if you're going to be white, be all the way. Bill Burr, Gaffigan, Louis C.K., you can't get whiter than that. You know what I mean? They're gingers and pale as a motherfucker. So, like, they've already got, they've already seen the dark-haired, blue-eyed comic. So now give us a guy who's, like, super white. So I don't know if there's any credence to that, but it is. There is something, like, it's still different than a regular white guy, than a regular dark-haired fucking white guy.
Yeah.
If you're going to be white, be really white. You can't wear a fucking hood, so just be super pale. Am I right, Steve?
Well, this guy was super white.
So then you can talk about, like, I still think on some level, comic as a comic, you're supposed to have a little bit, you're supposed to be sympathetic to a point. You know what I mean? So if you're super white... You know, I mean, Gaffigan's whole thing was like, I'm whitey, I'm the whitey, well, I'm the white,
palest.
I'm the whitiest of the white. Didn't he have like a white superhero character where he would go on
Force?
Yeah, he was going
on Conan.
Yeah, he go on Conan and say I'm pale Force. So it's like people are like, yeah, he's super white. Like I'm pale too, but I'm not pale enough. Like my dad had red hair. If I had red hair, I'd be talking all day about
that's
like.
That's not what your act is about anyway.
No, but that's what. But I'm
your
saying,
act is
but
being miserable.
Yeah, but no, but that's not my act. But I'm saying my act is like they for as a white guy, they expect your act to be a certain thing. If visually you can't, you're not different. Then they're like, okay, just do your white guy jokes. We know what they are. You don't like your wife. You don't like your
kids.
That's
not good. And that's not good either. They no more.
You can't get any traction. No one's gonna go. Oh my god.
No.
The reason this white guy got traction was because he did impersonations. Like he did an offbeat Bob Dylan.
Right. See, I'm working on a Bob Dylan, and it's going nowhere.
Yeah. He did a Louis C.K. impersonation.
Right. Louis C.K.
And he had a bit. And he had a bit about how the NFL commentators. How awkward it is when they have to promote the primetime lineup during the football game.
Yeah, I never thought about that.
Yeah, that's not funny.
No, but it's kind of true. Sometimes if the shows suck, they got to go like,
yeah, they got to.
You know they don't watch them.
Yeah. So that was his.
But it
that was the
bit. I could write for this guy.
That was the bit.
But it shouldn't be. We shouldn't have these archetypes where, like, if you see a guy with red hair and he's white on stage at a comedy club, that he has to say he's a ginger. Oh, here come the ginger joke.
But they do. They
but it
do.
It shouldn't be that way. Because
yeah, like, a lot of things shouldn't be, but they are.
If Gaffigan said, I'm the whitest guy, then you as a white guy got to find something else.
No, I'm just saying, like, there is a, people don't see, like, people who are looking from the outside in, they don't see, they see what they see.
Right.
They don't see there's a problem in comedy, because, like you said, there's a comedy boom, but they don't see as, like, they don't see, like, there's problems, like, if you're a certain kind of, like, if you're a black lesbian, you're set.
But you still have to be funny.
Huh? You still have to be funny, but you have a demographic right. That's new. Like, ask any club owner. White people do not support white comedy. Like, but if you're a black lesbian, they're going to come out because it's new. Anything new, they're going to support it. They're going to support it. So back in the day, they supported white comics because it was new. And then after a while, it's like it gets done. It's overplayed. But as a white comic, you're still like, okay, well, should I be able to work?
Well, that's what these Montreal showcases have become, too. It's not just, are you funny? It's, well, how do you fit in with my network's demographics?
Right.
So so in that sense, you're right. You know, the hashtag white privilege isn't quite as privileged.
There's no white privilege in comedy. I mean, people can act like there is, but there's white privilege in show business, but there's not white privilege in comedy. As like, working as a comic in a... in New York,
right.
The crowd they don't want to hear from you. Like, especially now with Trump as president, as a white guy, they don't want to fucking, like, white women, they don't want to hear a fucking word out of your mouth. Unless it's like, you know, I'm a piece of shit. You got to be like, you got to be the loser, you know? Because I was reading something about this. I don't know why this, the Mindy Project, you know, that's like, now it's on like Amazon or whatever.
Hulu. It's on Hulu.
Yeah, so they're like dragging us out. But again, like you can give these people sitcoms, but it ain't going to work because, you know, it's a novelty. But then when it gets on TV, there's not enough people to support it. And white people aren't going to watch the fucking Mindy Project because she's not funny like that. She's not funny like Don Rickles to use your fucking
example. I'll get in.
You know what I mean? So it's like it's the show business is all like, well, we need something new. And then when it's new, they're like, but even to defeat my own point, if you're white, they don't even want a white guy. They want a white guy with an accent. You know what I mean? Like the talk shows, Jim Jeffries now, John Oliver, the guy at fucking CBS. So it's like they don't even want a regular white guy to do talk shows.
Well, unless
a traditional white guy job.
Unless you're a sure thing. Like CBS went back to Kevin James and Matt LeBlanc.
Yeah, but not as a...
Because they were already sure things.
Yeah. And also, they're,
like, oh,
they're,
these guys are going to pull in people because they were
their ratings aren't even good. Their ratings aren't even good. They're like they're not canceled, but neither one's going to be a hit.
They're going to pick those white guys over a white guy who hasn't.
Right, exactly. So if you're like a new white guy, they're like, well, why haven't you made it? Because they think there's like a white privilege aspect. It's almost like they think there's a white privilege aspect to
why
it.
Why haven't you succeeded with your white privilege?
Yeah, why? So you had your chance with your white privilege, and you fucked it up, obviously. So now give everybody else a chance. I'm like,
well,
okay.
It might also be like, well, you're white. The world is your oyster. I'm just saying this is a perception. Why would you do comedy when you could just go out and be a banker or something
right.
and succeed at other things? You know, why do we want to hear that?
I work with somebody on Thursday night. She's saying, she goes, I'm not even going to name her name because she's been on the show. But I mean, she says, my husband is rich. He went to Harvard. He makes a lot of money. And even I know her. I'm sitting there thinking like, why are you doing stand-up?
Yeah, why are you doing
She's bitches about, like, her family doesn't think she should be doing stand-up, and, you know, her son doesn't think she should be... I'm like, what? And she's not even doing well. And I'm even thinking, like, why are you doing stand-up if your husband's doing so well? Like, you have to have a little sympathy from the audience
for them,
unless you're just killing. You know, it's just good to get up. That's why I'm saying, like, have a limp. Wait, when you do Last Comic Standing, by the time you walk to make that long walk to the mic, the crowd should probably know your act already, you know? Right. Like, if you have a limp, or you're a black dude, or you're a big, fat black woman, or whatever you are, they should know what the... Or you have glasses. Oh, he's a nerd! What a surprise, you know what I mean? So when she's saying, my husband, I'm like, get off the fucking stage.
I remember when I was young and trying to dabble in comedy myself.
Yeah.
I would ask for advice all the time, and headliner after headliner would tell me, you can only really do comedy if that's what you have to do.
Right, right.
Like, you don't just go, oh, I'm going to be a stand-up comedian. Like, that has to be the only thing you could possibly do. You can't imagine yourself doing any other line of work.
Yeah, like, what's your plan B? If you have a plan B, you're going to do your plan B.
Right.
A guy asked me one time, he was the headliner, he goes, what's your plan B? I go, what do you mean? He goes, if that doesn't work out, I'm like, I don't think I have one. I think he had one. I never heard from him again. I'm not even kidding. Like I was in like Texas or whatever years ago. But even that. Now I think it's different because now I think people go into stand up because they see so much stand up and they're like, oh, let me try stand up. Yeah. Because a lot of comics now they seem like they're not funny. You know, like they weren't funny back in the day too. But it just seems like people are a little bit funnier. Or like I see a lot of like guys starting out and they're just not inherently funny. You know?
Do you feel like it's a repeat of what happened in the 80s?
I do. I mean, because like you said, like the Netflix thing is like ridiculous, you know? So why would they go out? I'm already in my head. I'm not going to say it on this thing, but I'm already planning like what my strategy is. Because again, why would they go out when there's 20 Netflix specials to watch? Or there's 30 or there's 40? You know what I mean? Like they're assuming these are the best of the best. So why would they go out unless they know who you are? You know what I mean? What's the point of going out?
Have you seen any real impact in recent road gigs?
I just think that like the people that go out now, they're like they're getting free tickets or they come out to eat. You know, like on the road they come out to eat or whatever. Like
they
even
bring their oxygen pouches,
right? Like even fans of mine, they go, oh, I was gonna go, but then I had to pick up my daughter. I'm like, right. I know. It's easier not to go to the show than to go to the show. Because when you go to the show, it costs money, it takes effort. To sit home and watch fucking TV, it takes no effort. And Netflix is already paid, and it's still cheap for all the content they give you. So, you know, I mean, it definitely is going to be a factor. Like, I could see it even a factor, like, even if you do with Netflix. And the thing was a Netflix special, I asked you, because I don't know what you're taking. But, like, if you give an hour to Netflix, then what's your next hour? What are you touring with? Another hour? Like, isn't your Netflix hour your best hour? Like, if you've been doing stand-up 10 years or 15 years, like, if you do an hour, isn't that your best shit? It's your absolute best shit. And now your fucking sequel to that is what? It's just, like, forced, like, oh, this joke kills or this. Yeah.
And then
well, that's
what do you tour with? You can't promote an album like a band can. Right. You know.
I asked Ryan Hamilton about this.
He's a perfect example.
He has his first Netflix hour comes out at the end of August.
That'd be great.
And he said, you know, up in Montreal, he had maybe 20 minutes of new stuff he was working on, and just kind of mixing it in with his current hour, and hopefully
to be,
it's all newer stuff.
Yeah, but then when it comes out, first of all, it's not going to be as good, because the reason it got the Netflix was because it was good. Mm-hmm. So you can't. It's like you ask any band, you can't just go like if you have a good hour or a good album, you can't just go like we're going to make the other album as good, unless you're like the Beatles or somebody. But
yeah, with music, they talk about like the sophomore slump.
Yeah, so exactly.
Your best album was all the songs you've been working on for
10
years.
Right, so how is it different in comedy? It's actually worse in comedy because at least when you tour, you can do the album.
Right.
When everybody knows your jokes, they don't want to hear them.
It's no surprise anymore. At least with a song, you can hear it over again and you remember, oh, we
want to hear it. Yeah. My Sharona.
Exactly.
Remember My Sharona?
Yeah.
Suppose
Gloria.
They had to play that twice. I remember somebody saw
they
didn't
that. Have enough songs?
Yeah, they open with it and close with it.
There's too many comedians. It would be the same. This would be like if we took the NFL or the NBA and we made 10 times the number of teams so that every city in America could have a basketball or football team. You couldn't have enough talent to play on these teams. The reason that Louis C.K. and George Carlin are so great is because they are great talents and they're prolific. Do you understand that they're prolific?
I hate to bash Louis, but even Louis, like when I opened for Louis, in Philadelphia in November, you know, and he did, and it was, the crowd loved it, but it's like, it's not like every joke's a hit, you know what I mean? So like, if you do an hour, then you do the next hour, it's like, you know, the people who are your strictest fans will love it, but is it hilarious?
No.
The problem is, when Louis started doing that,
everybody thought they had to keep up with him.
Everybody thought they, but everybody's not as.
No, they're idiots. They're idiots because comics are so competitive and to a fault. You know what I mean?
And they're
like, and then Amy's like, I got to do my hour, and it's like, no, you don't. Nobody said you had to do an hour. You're not doing it for the money. Are you doing it for the ego?
The reps tell them.
Yeah, they're reps. I agree 100%.
Agent and their manager says you need to have a new hour this year. Everyone else has a new Netflix.
I agree 100%.
Why don't you have
and then they get you.
You need to cash in on this.
They get you a deal. They get paid. They get you a deal, and they think they're doing you a big fucking solid by getting you the special.
And then your special comes out and everybody hates it, and then you're like, what happened?
And they don't blame your agent.
They blame the internet.
No, they blame Amy. I mean, Amy got trashed when her special came out, you know?
Right. So then they blame the internet.
Oh, yeah. Well, she blames the internet.
Yeah.
But the point is that Amy...
When she shouldn't have made that hour.
Nobody was waiting for Amy to come out with an hour. Nobody. And even I asked Louis, I go, Louis, why are you doing an hour? He goes, well, I take it as a challenge. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. He's got a lot of fans, but still, you don't have to force an hour. You're not under contract, so they just put stuff out, and it's a content society now, but like, if you're not ready, don't do it.
But they don't have
it's
to
not
be...
Gonna...
They don't have to be Louis. In other words, like, you look at the comedians, and they see somebody get... I've been doing a long time, so I remember the first McNugget joke. That's how long I'm doing it. Then everybody saw one guy who was original doing McNugget. Now they all do McNugget jokes. So now everybody does Tinder jokes, all right? So now everybody sees Louis is doing a new hour and is prolific. So I'm going to be prolific. But you're not going to be prolific because you're not Louis. You're not George Carlin.
Even Louis is not. Even Louis so busy. Carlin,
that's part of how
Carlin
he did, challenges
Carlin didn't, have a, Carlin didn't have a TV show. He was just doing stand-up Strictly.
And even Carlin, who was putting out, even every one of Carlin's wasn't the best thing ever.
Right.
He had some uneven ones.
Louis' personality is to challenge himself. Do you understand that? That's part of Louis, what makes Louis Louis. Louis was making movies. Some movies bombed. Some movies did great. That's Louis' personality.
Right.
Get your own fucking personality.
No, but it's also what Sean said. They buy into the agent or the manager saying, like, you got to keep up.
Right.
You got to keep up. Even though you don't. I don't know where the fuck they think, like, well, you want to be up there with, like, you know, I see Kevin Hart. Kevin Hart's like, he's at the Cellar. He's like, oh, yeah, I'm working on a new hour. Like, for what? For what?
Right.
Just so you can say you have another hour? He's like, well, I want to keep up. You're already leading.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's like
they're already winning.
Yeah. So nobody and it's like that's part of like the whole thing of like the fucking comedy world, and even like I'm less friendly with comics now, partly because I don't want to get caught up in like what's this guy doing, because it's a fucking sickness. Did you hear what this guy's doing? Did you hear what this guy's doing? And then you go like, oh, what the fuck am I doing?
You know why they're always
doing my laundry?
You know why they're sorry to cut you off. Yeah, you know why they're always doing stuff? No different than somebody who wakes up on Saturday morning instead of sleeping late has a list of chores, so they feel that their life is productive. So they feel like I got to go shopping, I got to cut the lawn. What would comedians do if they just had to sit around and just be fucking human beings without the stupid jokes?
An analogy, but still, Steve.
Well, when I write a critical review of somebody's new hour, whether it's Netflix or Comedy Central or HBO or Showtime, I'm not so much criticizing the comedian, I'm criticizing their reps.
Because
there should be somebody in their inner circle who sees their hour and goes, you know what, half of this hour is garbage. We should do this as a half hour, or we should keep
or
working.
Wait.
Either make a half hour or wait until you have a good hour.
So I'm not going to say his name, but I know I'll just say his initials, TV.
Yeah.
And he got mad at you because you said he did an hour and he wasn't ready?
Yeah.
Listen, I've seen guys do, I'm not going to even say his name either because I'm friends with him. And people go, I thought it was called Burning Bridges. I'm like, I'm going to call the show Suck My Cock from now on, because I don't want to get beat. I already got enough guys against me. Yeah. But I saw this guy, he's like, I'm getting my hour ready for, I don't know if he was selling it or if already had it sold. I'm like, dude, you don't even have 10 minutes. Like, I've seen his 10 minutes of the seller. It's not that strong. So,
God, all these guys are putting on Facebook, I'm shooting my half hour special, self-produced. Well,
what did you say about him?
About TV?
Yeah, it just wasn't good.
Yeah, there was.
He wasn't ready. He wasn't ready for an hour.
I said there was.
Because an hour is a long fucking time.
But I did say in that review, which was otherwise harsh, I said there was 20 solid minutes, and I said there was this other bit that he only talked about for 2 minutes that he could build into a 20-minute set piece.
Right.
So I was like, there's something here. It just wasn't, this wasn't it.
He's a nice guy. Sean's a good guy.
But when you're a comic, you're so narcissistic that you skip right past that nice paragraph, and you just go, oh, this guy tried to kill my career with this.
Well, look
review.
At Kevin. He got a three-sentence review, and he's doing a whole radio show on it. You know what I mean?
Three-sentence review.
From the New York Times.
Right.
And he can't drop it. And they didn't even say anything.
On my website. You know what I do? If somebody groans, I say, I'll bring back the next guy. No matter what the show is, right. Even if it was Louis C.K., I do a joke. They're going, I'll bring back the last guy.
You should just go in front of 500 people and say, I left more people at my home or my car.
I've done so many shows in New York where I've been in so many different situations where I'm like, this is what you do. But did he challenge you? And also, another thing is, to his point, this is the New York Times. You weren't writing for the New York Times, right?
No.
I mean, you're writing a thing that a lot of comics do read.
Right.
So it's basically like comics. It's basically
the
what
industry people read it.
Industry people read it, to be fair.
Yeah.
So did he challenge you physically, or did he send you an email or something, or tweet?
A couple days after the review, I was brought on another podcast, which I won't name. Because
you mentioned him on a podcast.
No, they had me on, just like you're having me on. They had me on after I wrote it because they wanted to talk to me about the review. And then they ambushed me by having the comedian call into the show.
Oh, that's right. I read that. Okay.
Had the comedian call into the show. It was a live radio show on Sirius.
And they didn't tell you?
No. Well, I sort of had an inkling what was going on.
Who did it? Sherrod?
Yeah. Sherrod and Metzger.
What was the comedian? You know,
And what was the next show you're on? Sorry, Steve. What was the next show you're on?
I was also on Metzger's.
But when you addressed it.
Oh, well, I addressed it on that show. But then I met Theo.
So you're on a show. You mentioned, and then the next day you're on, and then they ambush you the next day after you did the review.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because the review got a lot of circulation on Facebook.
Okay.
And
so he said, "What the fuck are you doing?"
Yeah. Well, so did Metzger.
What, Metzger got mad too?
But Metzger got mad because, just on behalf of all comedians, because he didn't want me to turn into one of those social justice warrior types who is...
Oh, he knows you. Now he knows you're not going to do that.
So he framed it as he was worried that I was going to become one of those people who only likes comedians who are doing politically correct material.
You know what?
Is that what you said about the interview? That it was like...
Part of it was that it was like so like outdated stuff. Like stuff you would hear a comedian in like the Borscht Belt telling jokes. But then this last week in Montreal... Theo was there, and this other this woman who works at a comedy club introduced us in person. And I said, oh, hi, Theo, nice to finally meet you. And then I could see the look on his face as he registered who I was.
Yeah.
He's like, oh, I know who you are. And then you're the guy who's trying to burn me for life.
Really?
And then he immediately turned around, walked away, and then started bad-mouthing me to the next group of comedians.
A fucking
at
baby.
At the Hyatt.
Pathetic.
So. Whatever happened to, there are many.
But I wanted to say to him, I'm like, but you're at Montreal. Like, right. Even though I wrote a bad review of you.
How bad is he doing?
You're invited back to Montreal, so obviously I didn't do that
comedians
much.
Comedians don't want a fair fight, first of all. In the old days, they don't want a fucking fair fight. I'm sorry. Today, you get a little heckler. Somebody from the audience just says something, challenges you a little. Throw him out! Shut him up! You know what I mean? The comedian today is such a fucking bully, such a fucking Goliath.
No, they're all not Kevin.
David.
All snowflakes. And what I was going to say about the Borscht Belt.
That's the word I was looking for.
You were saying it was Borscht Belt kind of. That was another thing I think the New York Times guy had a problem with me because, you know, following this guy who was all like, you know, white people are this and white people are that. My set was more joke driven. Mm-hmm. And to him, it probably looked like I'm a hack. You know, they're like, the jokes are like my wife and my kids or whatever. Right. Even though they're all getting laughs and they're all relatively new jokes. He's like, well, you know, we've all heard this. I'm like, okay, well, I'm trying. These are the jokes and they're not that outdated because the people are laughing and it's a late show at the Cellar. And if it's a late show at the Cellar, they're not going to laugh at fucking outdated jokes because those are like, they're the toughest crowd. It's because they want they think they're the hippest.
The last
they're
thing
not gonna, they're not gonna,
late at night, they're tougher because they're
tired. And I shouldn't even be on.
Tired or drunk, or
I shouldn't even be on that show
tired
because
and drunk.
Yeah, tired and drunk. I shouldn't even. They should call that tired and drunk, but I shouldn't even be on that show because there's nobody in that room that has fucking kids or is married. So if the jokes are hacky, they're not gonna laugh. But this guy's like, it's easy for him to just throw me at the bin of like, this guy's a fucking hack.
Should it go back to the old days when the Cellar, the late show, was all the new comics?
Should it?
That's what I'm asking you.
I mean,
should
it kind of is.
Where?
It kind of is. She mostly puts like newer guys, and she puts me back there.
Like late night is for the people who are still making their bones.
Yeah, no. I mean, even when she puts me on, I never go, don't put me on that show. Mm-hmm. But I'm sometimes surprised when I'm on the late show because I have kids. It's like none of the people in the audience have kids unless they're black and they're not married. You know what I mean? So it's not like they're like, oh yeah, tell us about the wife and kids because if I'm doing well, it's because their jokes are funny. But this guy can just look at me and go like, hack. I mean, this guy before him, he was really pushing the envelope. Yeah, he's not doing jokes. That is pushing the envelope in a comedy room. It's like going to at a fucking rock show and reading a fucking newspaper.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because they're here to jokes, and if you're not giving them jokes, that is pushing the fucking envelope.
I think what's happening in comedy is it's becoming an elitist field where people want the chocolate martini.
He's
what?
Not every theory. Every theory.
No, I do know.
He heard you say fake news, so he's going after the elite.
Oh, listen. I was in the room. Mm-hmm. Rodney Dangerfield. Everybody agrees that Rodney Dangerfield's a legend, right? Rodney didn't care about all this bullshit. I was in the room when he was sitting at Catch a Rising Star with Joe Ansis, and he was recruiting people for the Young Comedian specials, and he's turning to Joe, and he's wearing like a bad polyester shirt. He looks like he's at Miami Beach.
Who Rodney?
So, yeah, and he turned to Joe Ansis. I was sitting behind him and he goes, hey, this guy's funny. Write him down. Joe writes it down on the back of a Con Ed bill. I swear to you. Joe answers the guy who taught the spritz to Lenny Bruce. And then Rodney goes up at Catch a Rising Star and his opening line to the audience is, hey, if your act works here. Could you cough over the whole story? Hey, if your act works here, you ain't got no act. So all the people.
If you're confusing everybody.
No, I'm not confusing.
What do you mean? If he's saying if your act works here, you ain't
what
got
no act?
What
I'm trying to say is if you're a hip comedian or if you're a hip New York comedian, you ain't got no act. All the people, come on.
That's not necessarily true, but I see his point.
No, come on. The people that hate Larry the Cable Guy, the people that hate the Jeff Foxworthys and the people like that. Come on.
I'm just saying. I mean, Sean's making a lot of good points. So,
thank you.
So that's why when I was reading your Facebook,
going back to scissoring. I got a new one for my fans: the box cutter. You don't scissor; you just take your lesbian pussy and rub it across the other pussy. Box cutting.
#. Anyway. No, I wanted to have you on because I was reading your stuff yesterday. I'm like, yeah, I'm sure comics have thin skin. Like, even people could say right now, like, I have a thin skin. Yeah. But also, I'm doing a show. If I didn't have a fucking show, I wouldn't be talking about it. I'd be bitching. But people are like, even my wife goes, yeah, he said quipped. He quipped. And she goes, that's like, and then she looks it up. She goes, that means witty. I go, what? No one's going to fucking look. No one thinks quip.
Right.
It's quip means.
That's what you put on your website. You put quipped. New York Times said, Kevin Brennan quipped.
Nobody associates quipping with being particularly hilarious or funny. You know what I mean? Like, well, any quipped. Right. Well, that's an old school word anyway. Well,
sometimes that's just a case of tired of writing joked.
You know what?
Too many times.
How many comedians have gotten shitty reviews?
What's a different word for joked?
Come on, Steve Martin went on stage. He got a really shitty review before he was just about to become the biggest comedian in America.
Anyway. Steve Martin
did not suck. He was about
to
watch
when you watch him when he
didn't fucking suck. He made me laugh so hard.
I watched that thing when he was on what was the show that he wrote for, and then he did stand up on it.
Smothers Brothers.
Smothers Brothers. He did like eight. He did like a. I saw it on YouTube. I'm like,
yeah, but that wasn't his act. He didn't.
Yeah, that was his act.
That wasn't his act.
No, that was his act before he became famous, and I'm like, this guy really sucked. He was the first alt comic. He was the first alt.
The point is, they wrote a bad.
His act was no act.
And that was really white privilege because black people weren't even allowed in the fucking studio. Steve,
he went on stage and instead of crying about a review.
How many good reviews did Dice get?
Dice, people hated Dice. And you know, not to play your game, Steve mentions Rodney Dangerfield, Tom Rickles, and Steve Martin to make his point. Mm-hmm. But Led Zeppelin, they used to get trashed all the time because when they came around, everybody was like, they wanted the Mamas and the Papas, that California fucking sound, the Beach Boys. And they were like, they were just loud and obnoxious. And the critics hated them. And then the fans loved it because they were different.
They were great.
They were
critical negativity does not mean that the critics are in sync with what the next thing is or they know what they're critiquing.
Right. I give Sean points because Sean hangs around the cellar. He did stand up. He knows more than the Xeno man does because this guy's not. First of all, how many times have you done stand up?
I did stand up from 96 to 2001.
So you've done enough stand up that you understand. So
how would you describe Kevin's act?
No, I don't want. I don't want to say that.
Never seen me.
I went this morning and I listened to your old album. I said that.
Yeah, I said it. Yeah.
Super funny. I'm a comedian.
I'm a hat.
What year did that come out?
No, you're not. You're absolutely not.
What year did that come out? That was the only album on Spotify. What was it?
2000. It was on Spotify.
Yeah.
I don't even know how to buy my stuff.
Yeah, yeah. And he was.
What year did that?
You were voted
2006.
Weren't you Aspen Comedy Best New Face?
Don't worry about that, Steve.
It was like a classic. It was like a classic.
Nothing
club,
positive on this
club
show.
Album. Like, yeah. You could tell that it was like recorded in one show. It wasn't like recorded over a weekend.
How would you describe his persona or personality?
He kind of like lets it all hang out. He does a lot of crowd work. He's not afraid to let the crowd like be a part of the show.
You know why people love Kevin?
Like, riff off of them.
Because he doesn't fucking smile. And I've talked about it a million times with other people. He goes on stage, says the things, looks like he doesn't fucking care, doesn't smile, doesn't fucking dress up, and people like it. It's real.
Yeah, you make me seem like a real schlub.
You're not a schlub.
He doesn't dress up.
Well, that would be me. If I didn't dress up, I'm Jewish, I would be a schlub. You're not a schlub. They like it from you. It's masculine.
You remember when the comic strip did that marathon show?
No, I'll just say this about my act. I never really liked my act because one of the reasons was because I always had the reason a podcast does better than my act is because I don't have to follow anybody. So if I had to do my podcast after Godfrey did his podcast or after Legion of Skanks did their podcast, they'd be like, "Oh, you're not as good." Or I'd have to adjust. I'd have to adjust my podcast to what they just heard. But because I don't
have to open with, I'll bring that podcast.
Yeah,
I'll bring
the other guys back. So with the podcast, I can just bore be myself.
Right.
Where in stand up, I can't. I got to do my jokes, even if I don't like them. I got to keep doing them because they get laughs, even if they don't represent my point of view. Now I got to keep doing them. You know, I mean, everybody kind of does their jokes past their shelf life, unless you're doing it like Louis does. And even then, you know, whatever. We've already talked about that part. But I'm saying, like, now my act is better because I'm more aggressive in on stage, especially when I do longer shows. I'm more aggressive on stage because I'm more aggressive on my podcast. So I just bring that more to, like, I'm just more aggressive in general, which I always wanted to be, but I couldn't really pull it off in my head because I was more worried about like doing well. And now I'm like, if I don't do well, it's like, it's probably the crowd's fault. Cause if I do good 9 times out of 10, the 10th time it's probably their fault. You know what I mean? Or unless I'm sick or unless I'm out of my game. So I like my act way more. So even people, cause even when I started doing my podcast, you know, I was telling Lenny, I go, Lenny, people love the podcast. He goes, well, I go, because everyone's coming up to me and said they love the podcast. They don't say it with my act. They don't come up and go, I love your act. Or, you know, some guy, like some new guys might do it. But now everybody loves my podcast. So I just knew my podcast was better than my act. But like I said, it's because I don't have to follow anybody. Because following people in stand-up kills. It's like that old, like from Annie Hall, Woody Allen's like, yeah, I got to follow this guy.
Comedian.
I got to follow this guy.
Comedy is not supposed to be comedy club. Comedian.
No, it's
like
eating.
Why don't we just have a steak? Then after a steak, we have an eggplant parm. Then after a fucking eggplant parm, we have another fucking steak. It's not the way it's done.
Oh, I know. And at some point, the crowd gets so, like, they get over.
You know what's funny?
Over,
he's going to give me a negative review for this podcast. I already see what's fucking going on. I'm the only one who's going to burn a bridge.
Can't wait to see what he says.
He's the nicest guy in the world until he writes about me
even
after
like
the show.
It's anti. And back in the day, it was like you could. I think you could
scissoring.
Be
like I wouldn't know what fucking scissoring is.
You're not a
I
lesbian.
Started teabagging this country. Nobody had a fucking teabagging joke before me.
But back in the day, like Bob. I'm thinking about like certain guys were like.
They didn't.
Like Dice Clay. How would Dice Clay even start his act now? Like you go up following, you know, like if you go up at
I saw him in Vegas.
You go up at a showcase show, right. You basically have to work within a range. Unless you're like Dave Attell where he's so outside the box. But if you're not like that, you basically have to work within a range. Like there's guys who I think are really good, don't work in comedy clubs that well because their act is different, like DC Benny or George Gallo. Like they're not typical.
You have to follow that stupid comedy club rhythm set up.
Yeah, no, it's all rhythm. It's all rhythm.
And every guy's got the same fucking rhythm and they're all saying he's unique, he's different. Set up punchline, set up punchline.
No, and that's why the black lesbian, that's how she stands out because she's still doing jokes, but she looks different, you know?
Doesn't matter. She doesn't understand. Why am I out of control? If she just said I'm a black lesbian, the MC could just say here's a, and I'm sure she's extremely
funny.
No,
I'm saying the crowd.
They could just say she's a black lesbian. She could stand there for 20 minutes. They'd be like, this is great. We're looking at a black lesbian.
Oh, I'm saying even if you're a black lesbian, you're still going to do setup punchline, but it looks different because you're a black lesbian. If you go up as Dice Clay or like Bobcat Goldthwait, right. Or like even DC Benny, like I see DC Benny, I'm like, I mean, if I had a club, he'd be there all the time because his act's different. And it's good, but like they don't, he doesn't. The crowd's not used to what he's doing. He does like
the tempo is different.
Right.
The tempo is different. So the MC, even the MCs today, they don't even like. Clear the palate. They just rush. Everybody's like, hurry up, get the next guy up.
Right.
Hurry up, get the next guy up. Hurry up, get the... No, do a minute.
You
got to
do what the last guy did, just a different version.
Yeah, you're within a certain, you know, like I did so much MCing. If you're bringing up Amy Foster, who's a clean, smart comedian, you can't do scissoring before you bring up Amy Foster.
You can do whatever you want. I'm saying as a comic, you have to work within a range of things. And now because I do my podcast, I get more used to like venting and like... Right. Learning, it's just helping me. Like when I go up on stage, I just like start. I come out more aggressive as opposed to like, you know, what do they want? I'm like, this is what I'm giving them.
You don't really
more aggressive. I'm more playing offense as opposed to defense. Like, what did the last guy do? How do I have to adjust that? Except for the guy I just followed in the.
Isn't that kind of part of a problem with Hollywood? In general, though,
yes.
You want to do like a unique, special movie, but the studios never want that. They just want the same thing.
They tell you.
And then when something does click because it's outside the box.
Now everybody does that.
But they go, oh, we want the next that.
And all the shows that are really good, they all say the same thing. We didn't listen to notes. The Daily Show, they like apparently like after a couple of months, they just wouldn't even read the notes. And the same with Seinfeld. And really, the only reason everybody wanted to do a Seinfeld after Seinfeld, but Seinfeld was like the original thing because Seinfeld was big enough where he's like, fuck it, I don't need this. Larry David did, but again, they were like, we're doing this show the way we do it because the notes they give you are always suck because they want you to be like all the other shows.
Right.
And then when it's shit, they go, it's your fault. So everyone tells you the same thing. Everyone tells you the same thing. When I did my last sitcom, I said we're gonna do it this way. We're gonna do this, and then they said they told my manager they go if you shoot this scene the way you want to shoot it, we're you're done. We're not gonna air it. We're not gonna edit it. Yeah, they basically said so I was gonna lose money because if the pilot got made, I would make a certain amount of money. They're basically saying we're not gonna make the pilot. We're never gonna air it.
How did you want to do it?
I just want to do a scene that was like pushing the envelope, like one of the final scenes of the show. It was pushing the envelope, and they were like no. And I said you want to do a safe. You want to do a scene like it's safe.
Well, it's like in movies. And they want to have a happy ending to every movie.
No, it wasn't even like, it was like a...
What was the actual scene? Could I just hear the actual scene?
What's the movie where they did in Vegas where the where Zach is in it, where it's the crazy
Hangover.
Yeah, I want to do like a crazy where the party scene, the after party scene is so like we want to have like a live chicken and because I don't want to set up the whole thing, but basically it was going to be like ridiculous.
Just got out of hand.
And it wasn't going to be like the Hangover where they have a fucking tiger and Mike Tyson all that shit, but it was going to be like that kind of where we're going to like it was going to be like a little bit not sitcom. It was going to be so ridiculous.
More absurd.
Yeah,
more
so
surreal.
Absurd. And they go, we're not doing it. And they go, if you do it, basically you're going to get punished. So the networks act like, and if I was bigger, I would have been like, suck my dick. Right. I would just go, I'll do whatever you want and I'll get another fucking sitcom with somebody else, you know?
That's how the Louis deal became so infamous. Was he was like, I'll take a lower fee as long as you give me no notes.
Right.
And then when that worked, every other comedian wanted the Louis
right.
deal. Like,
yeah.
Give me that deal.
Yeah, and even because he probably learned from his HBO show when he had writers and he had showrunners and he had HBO. Even though HBO is great, he's still getting notes. He's still making like a stew of like, this is your opinion. This is like whatever gets the vote, instead of just going like a pure vision of I'll make it cheap and I'll make it good. And again, when you make it like cheap and good and your own voice, it appeals to people more because it's more authentic. You know what I mean? It's not like
identify with it.
Huh?
Yeah, they can identify with
it. Yeah, or it's more pure. So then you go like, it might be weird, but they're still like, my wife watches Louis' show. I don't really watch it, but she goes, it's like real honest and authentic. You feel like you're watching like the guy's
fantastic.
Real.
Fantastic. And it doesn't have.
Real thing. He's like, it's the real thing. It's not some fucking.
Right. It doesn't have that sitcom.
Thing.
Again, going back to the bad comedy rhythm, set up punchline. It doesn't have that bad, pushy feeling. You're
yeah,
just like more
need,
like you're observing
a,
it.
Yeah, we need a laugh here.
Right.
So we got to make a jokey joke, you know?
Something to go into the commercial.
Right. Even we got into a big fight when I made my sitcom. The guy who was writing my showrunner, he goes, this is, you know, he made a big joke and then it was like we were in the act break or whatever, like where they go to commercial. And I go, that's not really a good joke. He goes, what the fuck do you want? I'm like, how about just not a big joke? How about just like a fucking something funny as opposed to like, ta-da, you know, right. but that's what they're used to.
Well, you know what? Can I talk about John DiResta?
No. John Travolta?
No. John DiResta was a New York City transit cop.
Yeah, I know him.
And
you know
he
John
got
DiResta?
Yeah.
Right. And he's really funny. And he got a show in Hollywood on UPN, which ended up being the lowest rated show ever. And I went to the
right. That stands out.
And I went to the writers'
you
meeting.
Get a Montreal on that.
Take that away from him.
Yeah, you can.
You guys are all selling the sizzle rather than the steak.
Mm-hmm.
So when I went to the writers' meeting, this is a New York City transit cop married with kids from New York City. All the writers have horn-rimmed glasses on. Do you know what I mean? Like,
oh, right, where
like
there's nobody.
Not one of them was from New York City. Not one of them even had a kid. The person that played his wife didn't even spend time with the real wife who she had an opportunity to be with.
Yeah. So David Tell calls the writers' rooms khakis and bagels.
He calls them, yeah.
Because when he wrote on Romano's show, even the
waspy
had,
Jews.
No, it's just like everybody wears khakis and they're all white guys wearing khakis and eating bagels, you know?
I'm glad you can't see my pants on this show.
Yeah, he's got it. He had the glasses. He would hear.
I'm
if
wearing
you put
khakis,
these on,
too. I like khakis. I got to do some plugs.
Johnny, you're such a nice guy. And I'm not just saying that because I know I'll get a bad review for you.
Oh, I like Sean because when I read that thing about like people are going after you, I'm like, it's so ridiculous. Like, you can't win.
I don't read
they
the
want to get reviewed, but they want you to whitewash it. And then what are you if you whitewash it?
Why am I even doing it?
Why if you're lying about if you you know I again I'm not talking I'm talking about I'm not talking about bad reporting.
Right.
Like this guy will say I didn't do bad reporting. I just misquoted. I didn't say what you wanted. But basically it was bad reporting because he didn't sell what. But if you watch a guy's Netflix thing and you go I didn't like that or that was your opinion. That's kind of what you're not reporting the fucking special because anyone can see it. You're giving your opinion on it, right?
Right. Well, also I'll watch it and I'll put the captions on, so that way I can see exactly what they're saying. I can go back and go, oh,
you're
this
a vicious.
Is exactly what they said.
Oh, good. John, you good. Seem like the nicest guy, but is your reporting vicious? How would you describe your
He's
reporting?
He's a nice guy.
Fair.
Oh, that's great. That is really nice.
Fair and balanced.
Fair and honest. I look at it as if I'm the manager agent, like giving them notes, like. Here's what's great.
You did stand up, so you've been on stage. You know.
That's what I was saying. Nobody would go watch a sporting event and not have zero knowledge of the sporting event. You see, I think what this gentleman was trying to do was just give vignettes of what he saw.
Yeah.
Vignette.
Total slice of
life. I don't really think he was saying anything poorly about you, Kev. I think the only thing in there that to me was not really reporting, and that's okay for the puff piece, was when he said maybe he does better in an alternative room. How do you know that? Have you been following this guy?
He probably knows. The guy probably does, because all rooms, they think, like, even all rooms, they think I'm a hack. Because I have jokes.
Where do you think you... No, you who says yeah. you're a hack? I never heard it.
My wife. Anyway, so... No, so I'm saying when you...
You think she's not writing the stories.
Oh, I know. She would fucking berate me. But the point is that, you know, if you're like... If you have a lot of jokes... I like jokes. I personally like jokes. I like jokes. I don't like...
Doesn't Attell have jokes?
I don't want to hear a guy's opinions. I don't need to hear a lot of... Especially with a younger fucking guy.
I have a lot of opinions,
guy.
Though, on stage.
No, but if a guy does a lot of opinions, they're not... Go to the fucking opinion club. You know what I mean?
I feel this. I get enough laughs that I almost need dramatic relief. Do you know what I mean? I almost need a moment or two of seriousness to balance it out.
I'm talking, if I go to an all room, they want this guy more than it, because this guy's like, he's different, because he's telling it like it is.
Provoking.
And it's not, the guy's not even telling it like it is. It'd be one thing if it was like really interesting and he was like, in my opinion, was like telling it like it was, but he just feed him garbage, like the white devil and this and that. It's like he's labeling everybody. He's labeling white people. And if I did that with him, I'd be like, oh, you're a terrorist, right? Because you have a fucking long beard. He'd be like, why is that? I'd be like, no, I'm just putting you in a box. So you just put me in a fucking box, you fucking piece of shit.
That's the Kevin Brennan we tuned into.
All right, so I'll be in Buffalo this.
That's a good segue.
I'll be in Buffalo.
Is that the lead in?
Shut the fuck up. Yeah, that's how I attract the audience. I scream, and then I do my plugs. August. It's August. Thank God. One more month with my fucking kids.
Where are you going to be in Buffalo?
One more month. Where do you think I got this fucking cough? My kids go to camp. I live in Jersey City. It's the most, it's officially the most ethnically diverse city in the country right now. So they go to camp. I don't know who's at camp. So I got this. They said, my doctor said I might have, rickets or sickle cell.
You don't have sickle cell, you're white. You don't have sickle cell.
On Long Island. They're like, sickle cell, because they're black.
You might have diabetes.
No, but the point is that I don't know. But I want my kids back in school because they suck. I don't need them around. They need to be busy. The devil's, what do they say? The
white devils?
Idle hands are the devil's workshop.
Yeah, or the details are in the devil.
I'll bring the other guy back.
Wow. Where are you going to be?
August 4th and 5th, I'll be at Buffalo Helium. Great club. Yep. Terrific guy. And then August 10, 11, and 12, I'll be in Fort Worth, Texas. What? And then I'll be in... Steve, give me a break. I'm trying to do it around my coughing. August 26, I'll be in Poughkeepsie. I actually have notes here. It says train. I'll take the train there.
Oh.
No, I'm going to take the train to Poughkeepsie because it's right across the street from the train station.
You go into Beacon.
No, they I take the train to Poughkeepsie, like FDR, and then I get off the train, and because I said, can I bring my opening act there? They go, no, you don't have to, because I don't have a car, so I usually try to bring somebody with me, so I don't have to. They go, no, you just do the show, and then blah, blah, blah. Anyway, thanks, Sean. I knew you weren't committed for the whole show. Thank you for staying for the whole show.
It was so much fun. I couldn't leave.
No, I'm going to make you a regular guest on the show, because I didn't know you did so much stand-up, so you're a very good guest. Steve, on the other hand, you're a piece of shit.
Is that the lead-in to where I'm going to be this
plug,
weekend?
Steve.
All right, I'll be at the Greenwich.
Why your arms aren't that good. Why are you wearing your fucking sleeveless?
Yeah, I was trying not
you're
to
You're trying to seduce.
That's what you do? The comic? That's all you could think about is that you didn't like my arms or that I'm sleeveless? Go ahead.
Put that on as critique. Put that on a...
Give me a quick critique, Sean. I could take it.
You're sexy.
Go ahead.
Blinded by your...
Go ahead.
By your guns.
You're a sexy middle-aged man, Steve.
Yeah, go ahead.
How do you get your arms tan? Where you go to a tanning thing? Are you vossing it?
No. I just walk around in the sun. I need more vitamin D.
Yeah, but it's all evenly tanned and everything.
I don't know. I evenly tan. I don't know.
You must go sleeveless often, right?
Yes.
You go to the beach?
I don't go to the beach. I play a lot of basketball.
When you're banging your better half, do you keep your top on?
The other night I did, actually.
It's a sexy look, right?
No, I like to be totally... But the other night I noticed that I did keep my shirt on. Mm-hmm. And I was like, you are getting fucking lazy. You know what I mean? But she was so happy she was getting banged, she couldn't care. I could have had a North Face jacket on. She wouldn't fucking care.
She's so happy.
Greenwich Village Comedy Club, that's how I lead in. Greenwich Village Comedy Club, Friday and Saturday. I'll be at Mount St. Mary's College, a Jesuit college for women, where I'll be making my sixth appearance, I believe October 13th.
Where's that?
It's up near Poughkeepsie Beacon, where you'll be going also.
Mount St. Mary's?
Yeah, it's a Jesuit women's college. And
right, Sean, you got any plugs?
No, just...
plug your things.
Well, I've got my website, thecomicscomic.com, and I have my own podcast. It's called The Comics Comic Presents Last Things First. This week's guest is Nate Bargatze.
Yeah, he's a good guy. He's
last week's episode was with Judd Apatow.
Wow, so you're getting better guests than me, Steve. Don't get too comfortable. Anyway, God bless. Go to the shows. Thanks for listening. Donate. Join.
Twitter me at Don't Behave. At Don't Behave Twitter.
Kevin Brennan 666. What's your Twitter?
Twitter is The Comics Comic.
Right. Great job, you guys. God bless.
Thanks, Kev.